Dick Amper here. Today we're going to revisit a film that truly shows the magnificence of one of the most ecologically significant communities on Long Island, Grasslands. Our program on it expressed how well the film captured the beauty of grasslands on eastern Long Island. Let's watch. Welcome to the Long Island Pine Barren Society program. I'm Dick Amper.
And I'm Kathleen Nasta. And today we're going to explore a really fantastic ecosystem, and that's grasslands.
That's right. Recently, the civic activist and video producer Seal Downs of the Akabonic Protection Organization produced the seventh in her series of nature programs, this one dealing exclusively with the appreciation of grasslands across Long Island.
So please sit back with us and enjoy learning about grasslands.
At the eastern end of Long Island, where the jaws of the North and South Forks gape, you'll see on the South Fork a creek bounded by barrier spits across the bay from Gardner's Island. We call it Akabonic Creek. Some call it Akabonic Harbor. We are the Akabonic Protection Committee, a group of citizens whose aim is to protect our creek and its watershed, its health and its beauty, for ourselves and for others, now and in the future. Some of us have believed for a long time that the original condition of the lands all around Akabonic Creek was grassy and not wooded the way you see it today. We have good evidence of this in maps like these from the 1830s that show little grass symbols on all the islands and most of the shores instead of the ones for trees. We have heard that the Indians who lived here used to burn over these grasslands. It made sense because undoubtedly it improved the hunting. Besides deer and rabbits, grass would have been full of birds, quail, grouse, turkeys, and so on. Later, the white man used a lot of springs for grazing because the soil here wasn't very good for agriculture. The Barbara Hale Refuge was once grazing for a dairy farm and later for beef cattle. Even old-timers living today remember the heart of Springs as being open space with short grass. You could see Gardner's Island from most of it. When you stop burning, stop grazing, stop mowing, the law of succession decrees that woods will gradually take over, though they are discouraged around Akabonic anyway, by salt spray during storms. So it has happened in Springs. Woods are common, while stretches like these are rare. Strangely, just at this time in history, there seems to be a great revival of love for grasslands and a great effort to preserve them where they still exist and even to restore them.
A key component of Long Island's biodiversity are its grasslands. At one time on Long Island, we estimate that about 60, maybe 70,000 acres of Long Island was clad in various different types of grassland communities, ranging from the very large Hempstead Plains in the western part of the island to the maritime grassland communities out on the South Fork at both the Shinnecock Hills and Montauk. And they are amazing places, grasslands. They're very, very beautiful, although it's a subtle beauty at first, but that subtle landscape will reveal its beauty as you spend some time really exploring the various grasslands that we have. The bird life that's found in grasslands is unique. It's very different than what you'll find in forests. Pretty much all the animal life is really that you find in our various grasslands is adapted to those grassland communities, and you don't find them in other places. And so one of the really nice, neat things to do to go out and explore these grasslands is to focus on some of the specialized biota that is found there. There are a variety of grass species that one can find in the grasslands of Long Island. There are really about a half a dozen or so species that dominate, and they include little blue stem grass, big blue stem grass, Indian grass, switchgrasses, the genus Panicum. Those are really the species that you find dominating the various grassland communities. And then there are many dozens of other species and variety of wildflowers that collectively make up the kind of floral component of these grassland areas that we have on the island.
So what we have here is a map of grasslands on the United States. This map is from 1924. However, if we had an older map up here, you would see even more of the acreage covered by grasslands. Some estimates actually say that almost a billion acres of the continental United States were covered by some type of grassland. And this would be in the 1850s or even earlier. And these grasslands teemed with wildlife, supported a wide variety of species, supported large buffalo herds, and were successful ecosystems. Around the early 1860s, with the Homestead Act, about 6 million settlers actually came to inhabit these areas. And when they arrived, they turned a lot of the grasslands into croplands. And unfortunately, they didn't know this would happen, but that ended up destroying the ecosystems and eventually leading to the Dust Bowl. As you can see over here on the map, Long Island is covered mostly in this green color as well, meaning that much of Long Island was also covered in grasslands in the not too distant past.
I'm here talking to John Turner, who is a renowned naturalist, an author, and a conservationist. And right now we're talking about grasslands.
Right. Thank you, Seal. And we find ourselves in the middle again of one of the more important grasslands found on Long Island, the Shinnecock Hills grassland, which is one of several maritime grassland communities or communities of grass that are found along the coast and influenced by the moderating climate of the oceans that are found on eastern Long Island. Long Island at one time had a number of different type of prairies and grasslands. Probably the most well-known was the Hempstead Plains further west from here, which was a more of a terrestrial grassland in the middle part of the Nassau County. It was thought to encompass more than 40,000 acres in extent in central Nassau County, pretty much where the modern-day Nassau Coliseum is situated, Nassau Community College. That was pretty much the center of this vast prairie that we had. The Hempstead Plains did constitute, apparently, the largest prairie east of the Mississippi. But moving out to eastern Long Island, there were a number of what we call maritime grasslands. That is, grasslands that were found along the coast and influenced to some extent by the maritime climate. And the Shinnecock Hills was one of those communities. The Shinnecock Hills really occurred from close to the canal eastward over to the village of Southampton. And that was the extent of it, up to Peconic Bay and down towards the Shinnecock Bay. And so you had this open grassland that you did have scattered shrubs within it, though, some woody plants. You did have some cedar, which we can see around us, red cedar, which is a common maritime tree. And then pitch pine, another maritime tree that you'll often find. But the dominant feature is, of course, the grasses. And today, unfortunately, like so many grasslands on Long Island, The Shinnecock Hills has been largely destroyed. And that's the sad thing, the Hempstead Plains, again, by far the largest grassland that existed on Long Island, encompassing about 60,000 acres across the center part of Nassau County. And you look at the historical photos and it's just beautiful to get, again, as far as the eye can see, you've got nothing but these prairie grasses. Hard to believe that on Long Island we had a prairie that large, that involved almost 100 square miles, but indeed we did. What the Nature Conservancy has done and other land managing agencies on Long Island have done, though, is move towards developing a program of prescribed burns with regard to grasslands. This has happened in the Pine Barrens, the grassland communities further west from here in the Pine Barrens. And you can see off into the distance over into the Shinnecock Hills Golf Course, give you some extent about how extensive this community once was. The golf course actively lets the grasses grow here. They realize that the grass is part of the overall beauty of the landscape, and it's much more beautiful this way than just having the horticultural grass that's used for the golf course itself. And so they probably the most, in terms of square footage, in terms of acreage, the largest remaining extent of the Shinnecock Hills really is found within the Shinnecock Hills Golf Course. You've got a fairly large patches of the grasses that exist here that provide habitat for a variety of insects and birds and small mammals. A lot of people, again, don't think of grasses as being flowering plants, but indeed they are. They do produce small inconspicuous flowers that are wind pollinated, really don't depend upon insects, but again, the very prairie grasses that we found in the great prairies out in the Midwest are the same grasses that are found in the prairies and the grasslands that we have on Long Island and actually in various places throughout New England and on the East Coast. If you really use your imagination, kind of close out the greens and the fairways, you do get some sense of what this must have looked like as a nothing but a natural system at one time. And it's a shame that we hadn't done a better job at preserving a more viable example of the Shinnecock Hills, that involving a couple hundred acres of contiguous grassland community. But that's probably not something that's possible to do nowadays, given the amount of development that's occurred. But it would have been a great goal to have had decades ago to have been able to preserve a real fine example of this natural community.
So here we are at the famous Vineyard Field, where a beautiful grassland has been restored by the Friends of the Long Pond Greenbelt. And they're represented here by Sandy Ferguson and Day Dayton, who are really, without them, it would never have happened.
The town of Southampton purchased Vineyard Field for open space preservation in 1998.
As part of the Long Pond Greenbelt?
Yes, identified mm-hmm. as a contiguous parcel in the Greenbelt. And however, at that time, there really wasn't a management plan to restore this in any way. But Friends of the Long Pond Greenbelt decided that we wanted to try and restore it as an open field. And so we tried to do this with volunteer work and volunteer help.
The volunteers never return because autumn olive has a thorn this long. So they would be impaled and they'd never come back. It was violent.
Yeah, it was. It's very difficult. It's because this had developed in the period of time between when the town purchased it and yet nothing had been done.
They were huge.
Yeah. I mean, we had a forest.
Yes.
One section of the field was fundamentally a forest.
If you can imagine this twice as tall.
Oh, easily.
Trunks like this, that's what was in the field. So this is just one full year's worth of growth. Yes.
And then we were notified by members of the town of Southampton's Environment Department, I think it was at that time, that they'd learned about a grant through the United States Department of Agriculture. And somebody from the County of Suffolk through Cornell Cooperative Extension looked at the criteria for the grant and said, guess what? Vineyard
this
Field
is perfect.
It's perfect.
It started us, yes.
Yeah, it really.
And because we had that grant, we could go to other people and ask for other grants.
Yeah.
And the project was ongoing, and people agreed that it was a good project, and we started getting more and more grants.
We were constantly working under the guidelines of both the grant itself mm-hmm. and the town of Southampton, who is the owner of the field. Yeah. But what happened was, we get the autumn olive removed. We're also dealing with other invasives in
Japanese
this field.
Japanese knotweed. Horrible giant patches of Japanese knotweed.
Yeah.
Which we also had to dig and smother. This whole section was dug. All the roots were dug, and you can see them drying on top. So we let the sun kill the roots. And then we lay down the fabric, and the pallets hold it down because it gets pretty windy in the field. So that's actually smothering anything that was left.
Not only have we worked with the town of Southampton, but right on the edge of the field is the South Fork Natural History Museum, and they've been a tremendous support to us. And a part of the reestablishment of native grasses, we've participated with the Long Island Native Plants Initiative, who is developing seedlings from native genome grasses. And we very much wanted to support that program, and so we buy their seedlings and we set them in the field.
Yeah, we use those to replant the Japanese knotweed plot. And now they're actually coming to our field to collect the seeds.
Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
And our field is also benefiting from the plants being present and
yes.
hopefully propagating, self-propagating throughout
it's
the field.
A source of its own renewal.
Yes.
Yeah. And one of the things that has happened too, and we're really lucky to have SOFO right at the edge. SOFO is the South Fork Natural History Museum. We're really lucky to have them at the edge of the field because they can monitor the bird life here.
Yes.
And one of the reasons that we got that starter grant from the USDA in the first place is that grassland birds are amongst the species that are being eliminated drastically across the country.
Because there are no grasslands.
No. Because there are no grasslands for them. And so we're really lucky because we have on-site daily records of the change in the bird population here in the field, of which we're really thrilled.
There's a beautiful trail system right around the edge. So you have a nice about 20-minute walk. It can be longer if you like. And then it also links into the whole trail system in the Lompang Greenbelt. You can actually walk to Mashashamuet Park if you'd like to.
So while grasslands were once a prominent feature of the natural landscape of Long Island, unfortunately today, very few small remnants remain of these once great grasslands. Looking at the map here, the Hempstead Plains, there's now about 100 acres left in this grassland system. At one point, there was about 60,000 acres of grasslands in this particular system that reached from Queens to Plainview. Here we have the Calverton grasslands, which are located in the town of Riverhead. It's also in the Pine Barrens, as well as in a special groundwater protection area. Unfortunately, this grassland is feeling a lot of pressure, development pressure, these recent years. Originally, these grasslands on Long Island were changed into farming lands and ranching lands, and slowly they were then turned into development. Residential development, industrial development, et cetera. So moving down the map, we have the Shinnecock Hills grassland area here, which is a relatively small grassland, but it's an amazing site and we're lucky to have it. There's a great trail to walk through to really feel the grassland ecosystem and learn about it yourself. So as we move down the map, in Montauk here, we have some of the coastal maritime grasslands. And historically, these grasslands were in part kept in a steady state as a grassland ecosystem because of the maritime climate. And the ocean winds, the salt spray, actually helped to keep that ecosystem as a grassland.
So here we are in Montauk at what they now call the Montauk County Park.
Right.
But it used to be the
Theodore Roosevelt County Park.
Theodore Roosevelt County Park, which sounds a little more colorful to me. And we're with Bruce Horwith, who's a great expert on grasslands and was with a project here for years, was it not a long time? Yeah. Just tell us about how that happened.
The project that you're talking about, or the involvement with the grasslands, goes back to about 1995 or so, when the Nature Conservancy partnered with the county who owns the park in order to maintain this area as a grassland. The park is about 1,100 acres. it's probably 100 or so acres that are in grassland. The rest of it's built up and, or, you know, grown up rather into trees and shrubs. But this is an area that not that long ago, meaning 50 years or so ago, was exclusively grasslands. You know, this was an area that had, none of the trees that we're looking at now were present then. But what's sort of interesting about what Montauk is, this is really one of the conservation treasures or gems for the whole country. Virtually the whole stretch of Montauk, with the exception of a few forest areas like the Montauk Point, was maintained as a grassland. Of that area, virtually all of it was either cut down if there was any cutting that was required. It was maintained in a low grass sort of habitat for livestock that were brought out from East Hampton in the summers. And then it was also burned regularly. The burning was to not only keep out woody plants, but also keep the tick population down. Now, of course, it's extremely difficult to put fire back onto the land because of the various regulations and the fact that it's more developed. Right around the early 1900s, several people, you know, recognized the fact that the grasslands, which were prevalent out in the park, were disappearing. They were disappearing in the sense that they were getting overgrown with trees, shrubs and trees. So the Nature Conservancy began an effort partnering with the county to try to bring, to try to maintain the area as a grassland. So from about 1995, an effort began to increase, to build up on the 30 or so acres that were in grassland back up to potentially about 200 to 300 acres. And at this point, there's probably a little over 100 acres that are, I guess by most definitions, a grassland, even though they might have a little bit more woody stuff in it than you might otherwise expect. But, you know, in pretty good shape as a grassland in terms of serving as a grassland ecologically for the species that are dependent on it. Yeah, as we look out through this field, we're looking at primarily switchgrass, and it has that nice feathery appearance from here. This is a particular type of grasslands that's strongly influenced by the proximity to the water, to the ocean. And so you have two main factors that influence this grassland tilted a little bit different direction than some other grasslands. One is the fact that you have the strong winds, but the second thing is the salt influence. And so a lot of the spray that comes out, even aside from hurricanes, which obviously add to it, a lot of that spray is loaded with salt, and it makes it, you know, puts the stress on plant life.
So here we are in Southampton, and we're with Suzanne Ruggles, who has created this beautiful flowering meadow that you see behind you and that we're going to look at in detail later. But I'd like to know, Suzanne, how you happened to do this.
Well, I was called in by Bobby Giannos, who owns this property. It's called Old Town Southampton. And he had a vision when he was very young of a flowering meadow. And since that time, when he was very young, he had always wanted to create a flowering meadow. So this is the fulfillment of a lifelong dream for him. When he called me in, we talked a lot about how native grasses and native flowers have co-evolved with the native mammals, reptiles, insects, butterflies, and he was completely on board with that. So what we have now is a predominantly native flower, native grass meadow. And the plants that we did choose all have a benefit for wildlife, whether it's building material or nectar or seed. We were very careful in what we chose. So what we have now is a working ecosystem. If you look on the internet about how to create a meadow in your own yard, the first thing they're going to tell you is to spray Roundup and kill everything. But I'm here to tell you, you don't have to do that. All you have to do is stop mowing. In most places, if the ground hasn't been sprayed over and over again with pesticides, there's going to be native grass seed bank under the soil. So I've done that on many properties. We just designate, we flag out the sections where you stop mowing, and the native grasses come up, and they're so beautiful. And then we inhabit those grasses with native plants. After a meadow is established, and especially after native plants are established, they don't require fertilizer or water or pesticides or even maintenance. They're perfectly suited to the environment in which they've evolved. This is one of the grasses that is not native. But the reason I chose this is because birds love to use it to build their nests. And you can see why. It's so soft to the touch. And it's just beautiful when the light hits it. That's Pycnanthemum muticum. It's also called mountain mint. It's a native, and it attracts beneficial insects. Look at the life in that plant. We don't deadhead them. In other words, we just let the seeds remain on the stalks. And when the seeds are mature, you walk through this meadow and you flush thousands of birds. They're all here to eat the echinacea seeds. There are about, I don't know, at least 20 varieties of goldenrod that are native to the Northeast. And this is one of them. And the butterflies actually depend on the goldenrod during their migration. This red plant, that's Lobelia cardinalis, a Northeast native, and it attracts hummingbirds. And you see how beautiful they mix in with the grasses. The predominant grass in this field is little bluestem, and it's such a beautiful backdrop to the flowers. So what we have now is a working ecosystem, and it's full of songbirds, dragonflies, pollinating insects. It's just alive here. The vibration is so beautiful. So it works.
There are a variety of rare wildflowers that are found in Long Island's grasslands. Perhaps the rarest is Agalinus acuta, or Sand Plain Gerardia is the common name for a very pretty wildflower that's a member of the Gerardia family that emerges in late summer, typically in September. The other rare state plant is the rock rose, genus Helianthemum. Common name for that whole group is called the sun drops because they really will open up in response to the sun, last for one day and fall off. There are a whole host of other species. One of the wildflowers that was absolutely abundant was the bird's foot violet. In fact, it was so abundant that reports in the literature say that it painted a pale purple haze around Easter time each year in the Hempstead Plains. There are a variety of bird species that utilize grassland habitats on Long Island, and they can be kind of broken into two groups. One are the birds of prey, and then songbirds. With regard to the birds of prey that you'll find if you spend some time in the grasslands are sparrowhawks or American kestrels. You can see northern rough-legged hawks in the wintertime. They will migrate down from areas from the north. Probably the most well-known bird of prey that's gotten some attention lately that likes to use Long Island's grasslands is the short-eared owl, which is a state-listed species, one that's become increasingly rare. With regard to the songbirds, probably the most well-known songbird nesting in Long Island's grasslands is the eastern meadowlark. And a good place, again, to see that is at Calverton, where the males like to display and call from the top of flower stalks. Grasshopper sparrows, there's a few species of sparrows that are found a little more subtle in coloration than eastern meadowlarks, but still very beautiful, interesting birds. The bird life of grasslands is fairly distinctive. These are species that depend upon grasslands, and their survival depends upon the continued existence of these grasslands. And so again, there are places of really kind of subtle beauty, but once if you really want to get down on your knees in some cases and take a look at some close-ups, you realize just what a beautiful, complex, intricate system the grasslands are on Long Island. And they're worth preserving because they are an important part of the biodiversity or biological diversity that we have on Long Island that originally comprised the island that we love. And if we want to try to protect and really reflect that full biological diversity that we have, a component of that has to be protecting the grasslands that we still do have.
Wow, that was an excellent program.
Great,
about
huh?
Grasslands.
Yep.
And just a wonderful video, another video from producer Seal Downs. Just
yep.
Amazing.
It's
so,
true.
Yeah. I'm Kathleen Nesta.
And I'm Dick Hamper.
We'll see you next time.